Now I'm delighted to introduce Loupière Guillaume. Hopefully he'll turn his video on soon so we can see him. Maybe unmute. So he's the founder and director of Amalte. I hope I've pronounced that correctly, Loupière.
Amalte indeed, yes.
And he's going to be talking about facilitating innovation management in a distributed world of working. Over to you.
Thank you. So let me see if you see my full screen.
Yeah, we've got your slides, fantastic.
Okay, perfect. So thank you everybody, hello. So so today I'm going to talk as well about communities of practice, which was the topic of Catherine partially just before. And in a sense, communities, what they are for, there are several types of communities. We heard about community everywhere. So what are they for? What are the types of communities? So just give you a background about community management and basically why I speak about it. Then who I am and how my, let's say, my career led me to have a strong interest on, let's say, practice in communities of practice in enterprise. And I will bring to you two use cases of COP meaning community of practice, to help you understand how they can be used, especially in the domain of innovation. And I will finalize, go with the three main drivers for success when you want to build or enhance communities of practice to drive innovation. So in a sense, what brings us today is we need to keep innovating despite the constraints of today, because we know we have a lot of constraints due to the COVID, working from home, the changing of the companies, lots of things moving faster and faster. And there are some, we know from facts and from studies, that communities can help innovation. And there are some very good lessons learned on how these communities have helped their companies speed up innovation or brought some innovative, let's say, insight or from sometimes some new products or new solutions into their companies. And now when you speak about communities, you may think, okay, I'm working from home, we are all teleworking, so how can you lead communities remotely, i.e. having what we call virtual communities? People with that who will never meet or very rarely meet, which means that the people who are leading these communities must have a kind of a sense on how to lead a virtual community. But since it's being in a community is a kind of an extra role on top of the rest that you have in the company, you encounter the lack of time for the person who leads the community, what I would call the community leader or community animator, and the lack of time for the members, which can be important if the members are in a business, in a kind of roles, job, where they need to, they work for clients, for example, and their time has to be accounted for inside a cost center. And then where do you put the cost center for community animation and for community participation? The tools are important, and as you know, this is the several topics of this today's conference. Tools, collaborative tools, they're important on how they can, let's say, leverage or hamper communities. When you have also group of people, let's say, exchanging about, let's say, work topics, gathering information and participating together and producing, let's say, new knowledge or best practice or innovation, is how do you valorize this work? First, for the people who did it, valorize for their company, their business, or valorize for their clients or suppliers, the stakeholders. And finally, there's also a little risk with communities, which is the risk of communitarianism, which means that community can have a tendency to close itself from the rest of the organization, which leads to groupthink, which can lead to a decrease in terms of attractiveness and decrease in terms of innovation produced. So this is a risk that should be taken factor in when you want to deal with communities, creating or rejuvenating communities in your organization. So what is a community of practice? So there is a strong, let's say, literature that started in a sense officially with a person called Mr. Wenger, who at the end of the 1990s came up with a study of the communities, with books about communities of practice, and which for him is in a sense a group of individuals who share their interests and problems on a specific topic, and they want to gain a greater degree of knowledge about what they are, let's say, interacting. And when they engage in these activities, they learn from their peers through mutual interaction. So when it started, communities were mostly physical, in the same place, meeting the same room, but today they are more and more virtual, and they virtual and multi-country, multi-continent worldwide. This, of course, has helped with the help of technology. And communities have become kind of a major player in the company. Also, it is horizontal, not an organization, transversal. It is, let's say, a kind of a body where people are volunteer. They have a role to play in three major things I'm going to describe you. And this list of the three main, let's say, domains where they can provide some great input comes from the research that has been, let's say, made for the last 20 years now. So the first, let's say, advantage is to help develop innovation, innovative knowledge. And how do they do that? Because these communities, people interact, they learn from the others, they can have a mandate from their management through, let's say, a kind of a sponsor who can say, I'll be interested in that you guys think about something. Or the community by itself can say, we're interested in pursuing this type of interest together. And it can, let's say, with a group of people inside this community, maybe not everybody, but a subgroup, work on some, let's say, problem solving, and at the end, come up with some innovation, which may lead, in some examples, I think about a construction company where the community came up with several stages with a kind of a new solution to sell to clients. And at the end, the small team within the community who thought about that began to, let's say, create a new business inside this company to sell this innovation to clients. But besides innovation, there is the other part, which is optimization of the processes. And this comes usually with best practices, sharing and reuse. Because when you are dealing with processes, you always want to improve the process to make it more efficient, faster, or other needs. And the main way to improve, as we know, is to learn from others. If you learn from others how to do things better than you do, then you are able to be better yourself. And globally, the whole company can benefit from this optimization because everybody has learned from their peers the best way of doing things. They can then adapt it locally, which means that at the end, globally, they can be much better overall. And the last one is to develop competencies because you are learning. You're learning from your peers about a given practice. Let's say you want to learn how to better, let's say, repair machines as when you are maintenance technicians. Then in that case, if you, with your peers, you learn some stories from them, how they manage to repair this equipment, at the end, you begin to be better. And if you develop your competency, then yourself, you can grow in your job. And if you are better and better, you can probably be promoted to a different job or having a better bonus or better pay because you are better at what you are doing. So committees can help the person, the members, to, let's say, to grow, to valorize them, and also put give some value to the whole company. Now, the term committees, they are everywhere. When you look at it, community is used in many circumstances. One of them, first one, is every tool that deals with digital collaboration offers, I would call it, communities in one click. You want a community, click here on the Yammer, you will get one, which means basically having a group of discussion. You run tools like Lumaps, Jalios, and others, which are kind of intranet tools. You want a community, click here, and you will get a kind of interface with a forum here. You will have, let's say, a title, some pages for news. You will have a place for documents. And you have your community in the box, easy to put, easy in place, and that's your community. That's one, this is the views of the vendors, and that's how people sometimes understand communities. Management also say, oh, communities is much more sexy than BU or support function. I've heard many times, let's say the HR director, the big HR SVP, the executive HR, saying, oh, we have the HR community. Or the CIO saying there is the IT community, which is basically everybody in IT, or everybody's HR is a big community, which, by the way, have its own Yammer group, for example, where the chief can post some messages and people can put some documents. And here we are, we have a community. And finally, many of you, I guess, are occurring or leading some program of digital transformation. And many of these programs leverage what is called ambassadors, a network of ambassadors where these people scattered everywhere in the company will be the people who are, let's say, helping the program to be in place and be deployed. So I will not go into more into other, let's say, way of using the term community, but just to say that community is not a team, not an operational team, because a team has, in that case, a leader, I would say a manager with some hierarchical relationship where they give basically orders in a sense, and you report to that person. Ultimately, you are evaluated every year to what you are doing, and you will get or not a bonus depending on his or her opinion about you. It's not a project team, because a project also is led by your project manager, who also asks you to do things for a given time. So you have some deliverables, you have some obligation to deliver a specific time, and a project will stop when the purpose of the project is over. It's not a tool, because it's not by clicking somewhere that you get a community. Because a community is a group of people who voluntarily go together. They are not managed, they are led by somebody that they choose usually, and it never stops until the community purpose is over. So it's very different from a project team or an organizational team. This being said, there is a sense of urgency. Why is it urgent now to consider really communities or practice inside your organization? On one hand, as you know, there are silos everywhere in many companies, probably in your company. And these silos, business, functions, countries, do not facilitate innovation because there is no cross-fertilization across people from business functions, let's say countries. And the bigger the company, the more difficult it is to have this cross here, especially if the middle management is not keen in encouraging this cross exchange, because it will lose the power it has on their troops. So that's one thing. Innovation, if it wants to do, you have to break the silo. We all know that. And communities are one of the means to break these silos. The other things is the famous NIH syndrome, not invented here syndrome, which we know prevents people to share and reuse best practice. Why? Because you tend to believe that what you do here in your own factory here is much better than what they do over there in this other factory, and even worse, in this foreign country where they don't even speak my language. So in that case, you say it's better here, so why would I share? Why would I reuse stuff from elsewhere? And if you don't share best practice, once again, you don't improve yourself and you're not overall improving the company processes. And the also thing is related to the virtual part, the virtual world, is the constraints of the physical distancing today that we have with teleworking, working from home, which reduce on-site meetings, which now you have to say, well, I have to learn how to lead group of people remotely, whether it is my team, whether it is my project, whether it is my community, how do I lead people who are elsewhere, people who may never see each other, how do I bring a sense of engagement among these people so that they can be together, happy together and exchange together. It is not that easy. It's not because you put people on Yammer that they will by nature, by like that, say, oh, let's exchange now. No. It's not like that. If you just do that, it will fail. So think about it. So why do I speak to you about that? There's a reason why. I've been in the domain of community management for the last 20 years something. I started my career as a consultant in document management. Then I went in big multinational like Schlumberger, Areva, Schneider Electric. And there I learned from Schlumberger, then I applied in Areva and especially in Schneider, communities and knowledge management in general to my to the need, to the purpose, to the benefit of the company. And they have a big conviction, which is we all know that we want to share and reuse knowledge because we know that it will save time, money for our organization and for ourselves. But I believe that this sharing and reusing will work only if we trust each other. You know, you share your stories, you share what happened with people, with friends who you trust. You will never say something that is not very, I would say, pleasant to her, to a stranger. So you really want to trust people that they will not say that everywhere, they will not transform or modify what you said. And this trust, when you look at it, it exists in communities, whether it is my family extended, sometimes my village, it can be also my community of practice, because I know that within them, we know each other, it will not go elsewhere. So for this, from this being having a long career as a practitioner in doing, in implementing communities of practice, implementing knowledge management programs, implementing collaboration with the collaboration tools, and of course the change management related to it. I've become consultant recently. I've been a speaker for many years and I'm still a speaker like I do today. I'm also a trainer doing some training in companies as well as in universities. And I'm authors. I've authored a couple of co-authored some books, co-authored some scientific articles. And I'm also writing in LinkedIn quite a lot. And at the end, I will give you some reference for you to have a look. And this is why I have a strong interest. And I would say I'm seen by my peers as a person who knows a lot about communities and how to implement them and how to ensure that they will live for a long time. So now I wanted to do a kind of a brainstorming, but I have a feeling that the chat is not the same in Zoom that it is elsewhere for you guys. So the chat will not work. So it's only one way. So I guess you can ask questions on the chat. And they will be given to me vocally, but if I do that, I don't think it will work, but think about it in your questions, is how communities can help innovation in your organization. Think about it, is would it help your organization to be more innovative? Think about it, I will give you 30 seconds to give you some thoughts about it.
I can try and link it together, Louis-Pierre, because anyone in the presentation group can ask in the chat that's here.
Okay,
and, please. And we have the rest of the audience, there's a chat elsewhere. I haven't got any questions for you from there yet. Let's see if anyone comes in from the from our group here.
Well, let's wait 20 seconds.
I've got a question for you while people are thinking. I agree with you totally that trust is important. A really important kind of component of innovation is actually creativity and creative thinking. And I think that we don't teach kind of creative thinking to our kids and in our universities. I think there's a huge kind of gap in our skill set in the people we're bringing into the workforce. Do you agree with me?
I agree with you, but I am today at a university to co-write a book on communities, and one of the authors is a teacher about innovation, and he teaches innovation and how do you, let's say, enable students to open their chakra, I would say, to be more innovative, and he teaches some ways, some tips and tricks on how to have people think, as I would all say, out of the box, which is a kind of an ugly way of seeing things. But that's, I agree with you, we don't give enough kids are very creative when they are young at the kindergarten. But then when they go older, the system of school forced them to be in boxes, to answer to questions and to be like that. The creativity tend to decline the older they get.
Your words lead me to a slightly sad story. One of my absolute heroes, Sir Ken Robinson, whose TED Talk in 2006 is the most watched TED Talk ever, 66 yeah. million views. It's 18 minutes, is exactly about that, exactly about how schools kind of iron out the creativity from kids when they start, from when they're, before they get to school, they're creative. We have a question from Gianna Imperatori that says, do you see communities of practice as something that is kind of on top of the normal project development work, or is the place where products and assets get actually developed?
I will give you an example. Example is a company that is a multinational in the game industry, which has some subsidiaries in several countries. One of them is in Quebec, in Canada, Montreal. And they said, okay, we run project. A game is a project. But we need to have people who build games, because when you have a game, it's a big project. You have people who are game designers, people doing the sound, people doing the special effect, people working on the history, people working on many things. And they decided that they will remove totally their verticals, their functions, their BUs related to, we have a BU related to the sound, one related to the game design, blah, blah, blah. They said, I'm going to replace all that with communities. One community for each of the, in French we call that métier, the kind of a job, a role that people have. So one community for game designer, one community for sound engineer, one community for this and that. And then these communities is the place where they learn from the other projects, i.e. other games, how to be better for the next games. And that, in that case, yes, communities are on top of the project, but it's not a waste of time because they meet, of course, after work. In that case, it's in Montreal, in bars, because that's the way it works. But in many companies, that's a way to improve yourself in the project. You are a member of your community. It takes, I would say, roughly 5% of your time. But even this 5% of your time gives you so many great value that you are willing to spend this time together. So I will not say it's an extra thing. It's not a job. It's a kind of voluntary activity that you will have for yourself.
Interesting. Luis Suarez has given an answer to your question. So he says, by identifying what doesn't work, tools, processes, etc., and letting them venture into how to address and fix them.
Agree. In a sense, yeah, I agree with you, Luis. Committees, usually, they can be helped for that. They can be given a kind of a mandate. Let's say we are in the communities of project management. We know there are some problems, like the process is not good, we are losing some money, the margin is lower, we want to improve. And we, you guys, since you're the experts, you are going to come up with some solutions that you're going to implement yourself within your own process. That's one example on how communities can help in that case.
Excellent.
So if there's no more, I would say...
No more suggestions, no more answers. Let me just check in the other chat just a second. No.
Okay.
But Lupier, that's been fantastic. Thank you so much.
How much time do you have left?
Well, we're intending to be going to a coffee break now, but we could if you wanted to say some more.
I wanted to show you one case. In that case, if you have a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
Well, the case is dealing with innovation. It's a company in the transport business.
Yeah.
And it says, well, we need to be more innovative markets because we know that we are today in the straightforward bus, trains, and so on. And we need to be more into what is called transport on demand, i.e. people call to get transported. It's not taxi, obviously. And they want to win some more contracts with cities on how to bring transport on demand. And in that case, they say, okay, how are we going to be innovative on this market? And they said the best way is to regroup people from different BU and functions, people from the operations, sales, innovation. And they created a committee of practice with one leader who was who basically led this group of people, about 200 people. And they used the social network, Yammer in that case, to discuss. And also they came up with several webinars and discussions and a place where they could store some information about what were the bids on that topic, what do people say with this topic of transport and demand, so that collectively they would improve their competencies, the sales will sell more because they will know how to better approach the city on the topic of transport and demand, and probably to be better when they will do the bidding process because they will have approached before by proposing some new ways of dealing with the transportation. And of course, they will deal with their failures and express how we failed on this bid, why, and then come up with better way to do it in the next time. So in that case, the community helps a lot. And the leader says the point of attention when dealing with the virtual community in that case is rigor. You have to be very ready in a sense to say, I want to make sure that the community, that the webinars are very well organized. We have some interaction between the members, there's some rituals to ensure that since we are virtual, if we don't have rituals, we will not be able to interact all together.
Excellent.
So that's the case. I will receive the case and I will end up with the three main drivers for success. You guys have to rethink your culture to promote this interaction, which is horizontal. You have to come up with creating some COP, virtual COP, which will help this horizontality. And use some tools which are modern that will help you, in that case, be better on that. And if you want to know more, don't hesitate, contact me. And you see my, to take a kind of, not a rendezvous, but a kind of a meeting. RDV in French meaning rendezvous, so I would say a meeting. And so that you can explain me your problem and I will give you some insight. Voilà, that's the deal.
Fantastic. Lupier, that's been great. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Big pleasure.